it's better. It's a lot better, but it still wasn't sealing. And so we ordered the new parts from Luke. We installed them. So the first ones we installed were this side here, and the top. So for these here, we reused the piece of metal because it kind of has an S curve, and it was just a tricky piece of metal. It curves, so it twists, and it does an S in it. So so we had to get that right. So we just refinished the piece that was in there. So we sanded it all down, painted it all, and used all new hardware. Same with the top piece. And so these pieces actually seal really well. On the top, since our door hangs down just a little bit, we actually used a piece of garage, that stuff that's at the bottom of a garage door. We used that to extend it down a little bit more so that there was a little bit more coverage. And I think you can see that big piece hanging down. That's actually what that is. It's a piece of garage. So we had the top and the front done for quite a while, and that's the way the door stayed because we had other projects and other things that we needed to work on, and quite frankly, we were just tired of working on the door. So we had this top latch, which was just, like I said, the residential handle, and it wouldn't hold anything shut. And if you wiggled the door a little bit, you could get the deadbolt to work. And so that's the way it stayed probably for a few months while we worked on it and brought it back and forth from our parking area. But then one day, I went to go unlock it, and the entire tumbler came out of the lock. So now we don't have a way to lock it or close it. And so we're like, all right, let's address the door. Let's just take some time and do it correctly, or more correctly than it was, and try to address the door. Michelle hated the residential style handle. Like, it had the scrolly bits on it, and she just hated that thing. And so she's like, whatever we do, let's get rid of the scrolly door thing. And I was like, okay, let's do that. And so we had read, we went looking online and did research on bus nuts online and all that stuff. And we had seen several people that used the latch mechanism from like a big diesel truck. And so those are really secure, and they really latch on well. And so we actually went to Quartzsite to see a few of the buses, and there was a few guys there running them. So they had the nice big latch. And the nice thing is, when you shut the door, there's a nice positive like clunk, and it grabs the actual door. So it's really, really secure. So we started looking into, okay, how can we make that happen on our door? So that was the next adventure, was trying to source out all these handles and wires and pulleys and all that stuff to get the door handle to operate the same way that it was when it was in a big rig. All right, so after we got back from Quartzsite and we saw people successfully using the handles out of big rigs and stuff like that, we decided to start looking around. In fact, there's a guy that published an article on the exact parts you need, and I think they're Kenworth parts or Peterbilt parts or something, but he has part numbers and strike plate part numbers and all that stuff. And so we started looking all that stuff up. We started taking the numbers he had and looking them up and seeing. So his total cost, he said, was about $150 for the mechanism, the clamper, the strike bolt, and for the inside piece. He said it was about $150 total. Here's all the part numbers, here's what they cost. So when we cross-referenced that and started looking up, for this outside handle, he was like, oh yeah, that should be about $35. Well, we looked it up and it was about $235. And then same with like, everything was like that. So the striker plate was the same. He said, oh, that should cost about $20, and it was more like $120. So it just kept adding up and up and up, where we would be like, well, it looks like to do that setup, it was going to be about $500 just in parts before you got to anything. So we're like, let's look around. Surely there's some kind of salvage yard or something like that. And so we did. We found a salvage yard in Phoenix, and we called up and said, hey, do you have handles? And the guy's like, we got all kinds of stuff. I can't tell you exactly what the part numbers and stuff are because these are just off of wrecked trucks. And so I went down there, and it's in South Phoenix, and I drove all the way down there and was looking around, and there was, I mean, there was just pieces and parts everywhere, but there was one section where it was kind of like the door graveyard. And they had a ton of doors. I actually found a cab that was wrecked, and it still had the door, and it worked. And so I was able to see how all the parts worked and how they were all linked and everything. And so one of the cool things was is I was able to remove all that stuff, and I was able to actually take a template of what the cutout in the metal door looked like for the actual piece. So that later when we went to install our door, that proved to be hugely beneficial because we had kind of a template that we could use to line it all up. And it isn't just like an oval. It's got a few notches and things like that cut out of it. So anyway, I took the outside door part, a rod, the clamper thing that clamps onto the bolt itself, and I think that's all I got from that truck. And then from a different door, I got the inside handle as well as another like a control rod thing. So we thought we had nearly, oh, and a handle. I got this chrome handle just in case we needed something to pull with. Anyway, I took it all up to the guy. I had spent all day taking everything apart, and at least a few hours taking everything apart and kind of gathering it all up, and I took it all up to the front, and I'm like, how much do you want for all this stuff? And so when I first went, he said, you know, it's going to be about $30 or so. And so I took all this stuff to him, and I said, you know, in addition, I also got this handle and this inside piece. And I said, how much do you want for it all? And he said, yeah, I told you $30. It's $30. So it was, we ended up getting the whole lot for $30. The problem was, is that it has a key, and it is keyed. But we did not have the key for it. This is a truck that was obviously rolled. The one side of it was totally smashed, and it looked like it like blown on its side or something. But anyway, there's a door cylinder in there, but there was no key. So I was like, well, that's got to be pretty easy. There's part numbers and stuff on there. And again, the answer was no, not that easy. We went to, this ended up being off of a Peterbilt. So, oh, I'm sorry, it was a Freightliner. So it ended up being off of a Freightliner. So there's a place out here called Freightliner of Arizona, which is a new truck parts place. So I called up and I said, look, I need the lock and the tumbler for the lock. And he was like, he's like, what's the VIN of your truck? And I'm like, well, that's where the story kind of goes a little cockeyed. It's actually off a wrecked truck, and I'm just using it for a bus conversion. And he said, well, he's like, come down here. We'll take a look. It's probably going to be about $40. So I was like, $40 for a door that I've already done a bunch of work on. That sounds good to me. So I went down there, and he showed me the $40 lock, and it was the wrong one. It wasn't gonna fit, and it wasn't gonna work. And so I was like, well, that stinks. And he's like, well, hold on. We've got a different part number, and we've got a different way of looking at stuff. And so he looked up another thing, and unfortunately, this one had five locks with it. So it had five locks and two keys, but he wanted $200 for it. And I'm like, oh man, back to that again. So, I said, look, I can't justify spending $200 on a lock where I paid $30 for the whole thing. I said, let me try to source it. I said, I know you have this one, and I know it fits, but let me just try to source it somewhere else, because I just can't justify spending $200 on that. And so anyway, we came back, and I just did a ton of internet searches, probably way more than $200 worth, just for the record. So we actually ended up finding the lock, and we got it shipped to us for like $45. So in the end, we paid $45 for it after a few hours of research, and it does. It's the exact right one, and it works, and it's all keyed the right way. So that's the story of the lock. So next, we had to go and put it in. And so the way this lock is designed to work it's designed to work below the actual clamp thing, because in a big rig, the handles are way down at the bottom of the door. They're like in the corner. So when you open it and then you kind of climb, you know, you open the door and then you kind of climb into the truck. And so for us, that meant we had to move our handle a lot lower. And there was no way we were going to use the full length of the rod. It was probably that long or so. So there was no way we were going to use that thing. So now we had to find a way to either make a new rod or modify the rod that it came with to get it to work. So we were able to do that. We modified the rod length. And this is the kind of the gripper thing it came with. And we couldn't just attach it to this door, because this door is just a very thin aluminum skin. And so what we had to do was then fabricate a piece of steel that this now sits in. So it's a 3/16 inch piece of steel, and then cut, you know, thread it and be able to secure it in here so that it fits. So that it's just about flush with the door. That was another issue, is there wasn't enough room, so we had to cut into the door. If you can see here, we've cut a notch into the door, and then we have, you can kind of see the plate right through that hole. We have a 3/16 inch plate that there's no way that's going to flex. So this is now all extremely stiff and secure, and so then We threaded in some holes that would accept the screws and accept the mounting holes. So now we have a striker. So for a while we had this, we had the clamp, and then on the other side, this is the striker that came off the truck. And you can't see it now, but the truck was kind of a baby metallic blue. So that's all worn off now. But in order to get that in, we had to use a Class 8 bolt. And so since we wouldn't be able to get into it from this side once there's a wall here, what we ended up doing was just tack welded two little tacks in there, and then not enough to heat the bolt up to change the structure and the strength of the steel, but enough just to hold it in place. So we have two little tacks in there that hold it in place, and now we can bolt this guy on nice and tight. And we had it so that we only had this and this, and so then when it closed, we had to rig up a piece of string. So I rigged up a piece of string that would then go through the door, and we would pull the piece of string to open the door. And that lasted about a week before we're like, I am so tired of pulling on the string, because one time we pulled on the string and the string broke off. So then what we had to do was go in, there's a little side door here, that's for the old refrigerator. This is where the refrigerator used to be. So Michelle crawled in there and went in through and pushed the lever down. So we got tired of that pretty quick. So the next step was to fit the actual handle into the door. And like I said, it's made to go below. So this was the best place that we could find. And as a side benefit, our kids who are a little bit smaller have an easier time than if the handle's way up here. So we got the lock, we got the handle, everything's ready to go. So we cut a hole here. We had to remove all of this. This is just decorative, just like a pan, like an aluminum panel. So we removed it and made the right size hole. And then on the inside, there's a rod that goes up all the way up through. I'm not sure if you can see it, but then connects to this bolt, and then those are connected via that rod. And so when you open the handle, it pulls the rod down and opens the little clampy C thing. So we installed that, got it all working, and then hooray, we have a working door. Just one issue, and that is when we close the door, it clamps on and it holds, and it's super secure, but we can't use the door opener the way that the Greyhound was, and that was the the chrome handle that we said you can push all the way in. You can't open the door then with the chrome handle because it's latched on. So you would have to go and pull the handle, and then you could use that. Just, we were like, there's got to be a way. So our friend Robert has a bus similar to this, and has a setup similar to this, actually, with one of these. And he said he actually just used a solenoid, like a car door lock solenoid, and he has a button up front that he just pushes, and then he can actuate the door. And so we're like, hey, we'll try that. So then we bought, off of eBay, we bought these real small actuators, and we mounted it right here. And so you can see these two wires are from that. And it does, it pulls, you can see here, it pulls the handle down.
I can't see with your hand. There, kind of.
Okay, so it pulls, you can watch it go down. It pulls the door down. So that would unlatch it from the driver's seat, and then we could use the door to actuate it. So anyway, that's the way we solved that problem. All right, so we'd had the top and the front done for a while, and we needed to seal the bottom. So on the bottom, the problem is under here, there's a piece of wood, and that piece of wood had corroded. So when you have things that are wood and they're from the 1950s, after a while they corrode. So that piece had corroded, and so we used it kind of as a template, but it was so far gone that we're like, okay, let's just try to make a new one. So we did, and we kerfed it, but even kerfing wasn't enough. So we put it over a boiling pot of water, and we took some pictures of it, and then put like a big heavy, I think it was a jar full of coins, to try to get the bend into it. But we did, we got the bend successfully done on that. And then we cut this piece of aluminum to sort of hold, we figured this would be kind of a high traffic area, and so that piece of aluminum kind of holds this rubber sealing piece on there really nicely. So that's half the story, and unfortunately that's the easy half. The other half was making the corresponding side over here, and that looks like, oh man, that wouldn't be that hard. But this piece, we've made this piece, I think, 5 times total, where we've tried to cut it and then sand it to the right shape, and it's too fat, or it's too big, or it doesn't seal, or one piece we had and it was almost perfect, and we had pre-drilled it and everything to make sure that we wouldn't crack it, and we drilled it in and it cracked anyway. So we tried to then repair it, which didn't work. And when we first started out, we had the wrong tools. So we had just a really bad jigsaw, and it just would not cut straight up and down. And so the piece would kind of go like that, and we just had the hardest time with this. Finally, recently, we got a bandsaw, and it turns out the bandsaw is the right tool for this job. So with the bandsaw, we were able to cut two of these, faster than we cut the very first one. So we cut two of these, and we got it to the exact right size, and we're up underneath, and we're measuring, and we're making sure that it shuts. So this part could be a whole story in all of itself, just the hard time that we had, not only because it had to fit perfectly on this side, but the door also has a bunch of like plates in odd places and bolts that stick out that we had to like router around and make little router imprints for. And so we finally got this correct, and it seals really nicely. So the piece of wood that we took out that was on the other side, it was the strangest piece of wood. It was all kind of falling apart, but the way they had put it together, it was almost as if they'd used like just pieces of like old pallet. Like, I don't even think they were the same kinds of wood. They just kind of glued and screwed and stapled two pieces of wood together to kind of get it to sort of be the right shape. And then they used a big thick foam layer around the bottom to try to seal the bottom, which maybe it worked. I kind of just don't think it ever really worked very well. So anyway, that's the story of getting the bottom of this thing sealed.